So hopefully you'll do it again and we can get more attendance.
Yeah,
really,
I think we're going to make it a series.
So why don't you tell a couple things, just a basic format.
So just for new agents, everybody can hear me in the back, how to win in multiple offer situations and kind of best practices on writing the contracts correctly, which is important, right, Bobby? Checking the right boxes, and we worked with an escalation clause that was interesting. Very well written, if I must say so much.
And that's one of the things that you have given me the segue that I wanted to bring up to you. So, you know, I knew the escalation clause was going to happen.
Right.
And I thought about that a lot because I'm not a fan of escalation clauses. And most brokers, because of why? What was the sort of the pitfalls of an escalation clause? Potentially. Especially if they didn't write it
correctly,
which if you ever want to have the wording for an escalation clause that no one would ever understand and would sign and be in agreement to just because it sounded so
good.
Bonafide.
I'll send it to you.
Sealy.
That's easy. You said M1? Correct.
Right, because they went, this has
got
to
be the best deal.
Can we just have a class on that escalation?
Yeah, that's right. Yes.
Yeah,
so
we do. If you see an escalation clause, it looks like this.
Yes. Call your attorney.
The reason I am bringing it up, because I thought about it, and I wanted to commend you on such a well-written escalation.
I didn't write it, but I will take credit for it.
So I didn't want you to walk away thinking that I was down on you,
yeah,
so to speak. Because it was very, very good. My problem with escalation clause has always been that, A, even if you show one, you're not necessarily the one you were going to pick. You're escalating it automatically up to whatever. So the buyer's given their highest number.
Right.
You already know what the goal is.
Right.
And it opens to me some potential for some maybe dishonesty.
Yeah. Oh, for
I
sure.
mean, I'm not sure that would ever happen.
Not
but
a real never.
Potentially there could be, right? So, as brokers, what I know we're on a different side. I know that a lot of agents have had very great success with them in many cases. But as brokers, why do you each, other than those that I talked about myself, what's your kind of feelings and why? Even though you've written the most phenomenal one.
Well, Lee does have the most phenomenal. I've never seen that one yesterday.
I stole it. I would love to take credit for it. But it
I
was,
mean, I lost track.
It's, oh, yeah.
It's
it,
like,
it, it,
like,
you, so that was
like,
I got her.
Do y'all remember
1-7
in the
working
with, it's paragraph 7,
yeah,
the longest single sentence that's ever written.
Yeah.
Tyler.
No. I'm with you, I agree. I don't like to use them, but I have seen them win offers in the past. So, you know, I think it's a case-by-case situation.
Do you think that agents spend enough time explaining to their buyers exactly what this is going to be and what it could, like the good news, bad news, the risk, the not risk, or do they just say, this is
no,
a great idea?
I don't think they explain that. And I don't know if... There's a lot of things that agents don't explain that I really coach on the front end, explain as much as you can, over-communicate. And I think escalation clauses are one of those things that you can't really, you don't know it's going to happen until it happens. But,
right. Yeah. Is this going to be an appraisal situation most of the time, I feel like? Unless it's a underpriced property or a cash deal or something.
Yeah, so if somebody pays over knowing it probably won't appraise, they know they've got sort of a bottom line scape out, you know, thinking out. So then it loses some. And I don't think agents for sellers spend enough time sharing with sellers, hey, this might be the highest price,
right,
but, you know, if it doesn't appraise, we're back to square one and we've lost other.
Right.
Well, I really enjoyed that. That was great. Anything else that you guys got out of that that you think was worthy to share with the village?
I don't know, I thought it was really good. I was surprised. I wasn't surprised it was really well attended, but I was happy that it was really well attended. Because we didn't really know. At first, there was only like 7 people signed up, and then a week went by, and it was like packed. So it was really cool.
It really was. So, I'm going to ask them some questions, and then I'm going to get into more stump the broker. So both of you, what did you each do before you became brokers?
Who do you want to answer first? We're going to let you answer.
I just think I make sense for you.
That's fine.
Okay.
I worked in the wireless industry, answering lovely questions about your cell phones and Blackberries. And all kinds of stuff. So that's what I did. Wireless.
Okay. Tyler?
I worked at Starbucks.
Yeah. Wow. A barista. Or the barista.
That was the job right before I made the job. Well, I guess technically it would have been property management, but if you're talking about real estate, you know, I kind of lumped that into.
So when did you each get your licenses?
2011.
Okay. And so you had real estate as a primary business. And then you decided it would be a great idea to be a broker. How did that come about? In your case, you're a family of brokers,
right.
You're a descendant.
I was new to, long lineage. I was new to Nashville in the real estate because I only really got started in Nashville real estate at the end of 2016. So 2017 was really my first year. And I was also in Franklin. So I was by far the youngest in my office. And so I thought maybe having broker next to my name would make me kind of stand out and look like I actually knew what I was talking about and I wasn't some little kid, which is what I was kind of. Someone told me once that good luck getting listings, and I thought, okay, fine. I thought a few words, but didn't say them. I didn't want to become a managing broker. My mom's a managing broker, and so I really wanted to pursue that path, and I knew like the sooner I got that, the sooner I could make that happen. So.
And so I have to say something about you, Tyler. The first time I met you was at a small broker forum at Worth Properties, where a lot of us got together and sit around a table and talk about what it was. And I looked across, we were way across the table, and you said you were with who?
Bradford,
which I hadn't heard of, but you were so, and I want to say this to you, so articulate and so well versed.
I'm surprised you remember that, Bobby.
I do.
Yeah,
it was an intimate moment. But you were so articulate and so well poised, and I was very impressed with your ability and being rather new into that arena. You seemed very much like you had a handle.
I was new. That's why I was surprised you remember me, because I thought I was like nobody. Like, here's
you
all
were.
These people
That's
in this room
so
that have been
amazing.
In this business for
I
years.
Thought, who is this nobody with such
yeah.
a good poise and confidence?
Thanks until you make it. That's that. But I honestly, I didn't ever think I was going to be managing broker. It was just sort of the way that the cards fell after I got out of business school. I was approached by an agent who had been in business for 15 years here in Nashville. He wanted to start his own company, which eventually turned into Bradford. But you know, I had an MBA and I had real estate experience, and he asked if I wanted to be a broker and thought it was a good opportunity. So I took it.
And I was very impressed. You, I hadn't ever met until you came to Village, and then it was so blown away.
Yeah.
It's interesting. So both of you were in these previous broker positions. You were like an assistant broker to in Carlyle.
Yes, ma'am.
So how was it possible? It's only been about a year and a half, 2 years. Is it two that you've been in building?
Yeah. Oh, for me,
April
yeah.
was one.
It'll be a year.
Yeah. So it's yeah. Okay. How did we manage to steal away? Basically, why did you decide that this would be a good change for you? I'm going to move to this chair so I'm not looking. I can look at both.
She wants to sit across from me.
I do. I really am tired.
Who do you want to answer first?
This is good. I like you going first. I can think about my answer.
I was at Ari Barkin.
So you can kind of turn this way and kind of talk. We'll kind of see it. So there's.
Come back here.
Here's the
You want me to talk to the camera? Or
kind of. Well, to the camera-ish.
I was at Ari Bar Camp, and Chris and I, when he was here, approached me and said, hey, I know that you're happy where you are. I would just love to talk to you. We have some opportunities coming open at Village. And I was like, yeah, I'm not really interested in moving, but sure, let's go chat. So I met him at the Wedgwood Houston office before it was open. And I walked in and saw Zach Brickner, who I had met with the National Junior Chamber, and love Zach. And so we met, had coffee, and we talked about it. And I said, okay, let me think about it, because I really didn't want to move. My mom was also a managing broker with Cry Like in Memphis, so I knew that was going to be a fun conversation to have if I was leaving the family business or whatever, really. But so I thought about it. I actually called Loy. This was before Loy was coming over to Village. He was at Rudy Tidal, trying to pry, maybe get some good information out. And I didn't know it at the time, but they were also courting or speaking with Loy to come to Village too. So he was very politically correct, I guess you could say. Village is an amazing place, period. Like, did not say anything, but obviously it is true. But I knew having his blessing and like his encouraging words was good. And I also spoke with my broker, who was really awesome, and I told her the opportunity, and she said, absolutely, you should take it. This is the best thing for your career. So knowing that, I thought that was really awesome, because usually that's not the conversation that goes down with your broker when you're leaving. And so it's usually a different, like, here's your paper lead. So I knew that that was a positive thing. And I also had known Village in the community. So.
Well, you're lucky.
I'm thankful to be here.
So while I was doing a lot of recruiting of Village agents when I was at Bradford and other agents around town, but so I was really trying to steal a lot of them away to come to our new startup brokerage. But through that process, I actually made a lot of friendships with Village agents, and I was always impressed with the Village agents specifically. I think they just kind of felt like my tribe. Like, those were the kind of people I wanted to get to pull into my home. And then one thing led to another. We didn't, the owner of the last company I was with, and he and I didn't really see eye to eye on how the company was going to move forward. And kind of in that talking with him, I got a phone call from Loy and Chris, and they said, hey, we have an opening in the East office, and would you even want to talk to us? We know you're an owner at this company, but we don't know. Would you want to chat? So we sat down for lunch, and that all happened within literally like 2 weeks. So I had a conversation with the owner of Bradford, and then had a phone call from them, and we sat down and had lunch. So
we owe great debt of gratitude to Loy.
Oh gosh, no.
And it was really tough, because I went back to the owner of Bradford and told him, you know, hey, like, if we can't make this work, then I'm thinking about leaving. And his words were not encouraging. It was, if you leave, that'll be the worst mistake of your life.
That's what he said.
Essentially, yeah. He said you'll never have a better opportunity than this. And I didn't really like that answer.
obviously.
It's kind of like your response when they said, hey, you're going to sell and.
Oh, yeah. We'll discuss that shortly. After the break.
I didn't like that response. I felt like I could do more, and I wanted to build more. And so when he said that, it just didn't resonate. And so I actually had. I called Robbie Stone, because Robbie was one of the agents who I'd become friends with.
We all were champions, right?
Yes, lip sync battle champs, and we've done a lot together. And I'd learned from other Village agents, you know, the East office, and there'd been a lot of changeover and things like that, and that there was going to need to be sort of a culture shift. And so I sat down with Robbie and I said, hey, like, I'm thinking about doing this. But if I'm going to do it, I need you. And really, that That sealed the deal.
Yeah.
Oh,
and I didn't know Lee. I didn't know Lee.
And then Robbie promptly left WeHo and went to his.
It was so great.
But we moved on.
Now we're offering. Now we're offering.
We're offering.
Good. I like those. Those are neat stories. And it really shows what people move because of community and relationships. And that's what we build here. Remind me sometime before we get further in that I want to go back to something from yesterday about delivery. Will you remind me of that? Don't everybody forget delivery.
Sure.
Okay. So I'm going to ask you to do something interesting. Instead of telling, you've had these questions, so you should have been ready. All right. So would you agree, as I think, everybody out there, these are two brokers, both at Village, both in different offices, and that they have a different style, would you say? I mean, they are both very outgoing and very warm and friendly, but there is a different brokering style, potentially, and each office is going to have a different kind of culture. So rather than you explain your own, I'm going to ask Tyler to tell me his opinion of Lee's brokering style.
that's tough. I mean, you know, I don't hang out in the WeHo office.
Brokerage,
yeah.
Well, I know. I fully knew that when I put this question to you. But you are in broker meetings together. We engage as a team in a lot of ways. And so you listen to each other. You also probably talk to each other's agents at various times. So this is not going to be cast in stone or necessarily correct. But your opinion of his style, not if he's a good or bad broker.
Right.
Obviously, he's bad.
The best.
But style-wise, what do you see in his style that might be, I don't want you to talk about yours, just tell me what you think his style of broker.
I think his style is very, this is hard. I think proactive, I think, is a good word for it. Like, I think I don't know if that's because your office, you're forced to sit in the middle of your office,
right.
So everyone has access
no
to you all the time. But, I mean, you're always really quick to respond to people. I think you're eager to help any way you can. I think you go above and beyond when agents ask you to do so. But that's not really a style.
No, it is.
But,
yeah, that's good.
I mean, you're outgoing and personable and maybe a little louder than I am. But that's good. I mean, I think a lot of agents like that. And upon that, sort of their style, their personality.
Yeah. And I mean, obviously, as brokers, you're going to have similar things. But what do you see in a similar, you know, in Tyler, what do you see as a broker?
I think we have a lot of similarities in our personality, kind of how we deliver the message and everything. Every time I come to the East office, he's definitely community with the agents. He's in the attic a lot of times. Like, having really good conversations, it's a really like a fun experience. And so I think, I don't know, that's a hard question. It's a very hard question.
What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna ask right now, based on what they just said, do you see differences or similarities? What
Robbie's had us both, so.
Oh,
Robbie's,
yeah.
Wow,
I'm on the
spot. Wow, since you've had
that. Well, what
the guy? What do you think, Robbie? This isn't a good, bad. This is just different. The nuances that make a difference, which do, in essence, create a culture in each office. So each office has a different, and that's a good example that you've been to both. So.
Yeah. I mean, I think Village attracts a certain style agent, and especially a certain style broker. And both of them definitely fit in with that idea that culture is extremely important. Not only just being there on a professional level, but a personal level. And when you're kind of, they're both very intuitive. So, like, I know if I walk into the office and I'm having a day, they're probably, each one of them would notice and in a appropriate way ask questions to make sure everything's okay and then assist if needed, which I appreciate about how both of them lead. I think Lee's maybe like, I don't know, the difference, they're kind of similar. Lee's definitely like a laid back, let everyone do. The WeHo office is interesting because it was a lot of very experienced agents.
Right.
So it was very much like, I'm here if you need me, of course, but y'all do your thing. I want to be a support to what you're already, the great things you're doing. Tyler's is, we do have some newer agents, so it's a bit more involved in kind of laying the groundwork and helping kind of build that foundation for them instead of supporting already existing businesses. So I think
that's a good insight. Anybody else, just from what you've seen, I know you not all have been under their actual brokerage, but what do you see?
I'm with Lee.
Yeah, I'm with Lee. I
was in some classes with Tyler. I love similar personalities. I've got to work with Tyler. All I can say as a newer agent with Lee, he's been just, I mean, I had a deal I was trying to take from another brokerage to Village. It was in the middle, and Lee helped me. He was just so happy and nice and friendly, and I was like, oh my God, this is great. I love him. Very hands-on. He's always very available and very encouraging. We've gone to lunch several times just to kind of touch base and cheer me on and talk about what we're doing. So he's very warm and encouraging, and I'm a warm, other person, so have fun.
Anybody else have something? And really the point of this is I wanted to share that's the wonderful thing I think that Village has created that's unique is this Village team. Even though you're in a different, you may not be in the office, I'm hoping that the broker team appears as sort of a unified front to the agents and so that you can feel comfortable, but knowing that there's a different style, which is fine, but you're going to experience that kind of caring and warmth, which I'm hearing that you're saying.
Well, we worked really hard. I mean, ever since I came over to Village, I mean, the broker team, we met so many times. We went on a couple different retreats. We went to your house one time. I mean, we worked really hard to sort of get to know each other and each other's styles so then we could work off each other's strengths and kind of have that unified team.
But you say there's a unique selling proposition. A lot of times in most companies, it's this is your office, this is your broker, and there's not that team effect of brokers, which I think is an interesting dynamic that's kind of evolved over, especially since you came on board. There's been much more of an involvement of the brokers and support, I think. And I like it. I think it's something that benefits the agents. So, having said that, what would you say your differences are? I know everybody's saying they're wrong, because I think you're very different. You all said they have the same personality. Of course, I know them more because I've been involved with their meetings, but I don't see you, and they've all said you have similar personalities, and I'm missing them.
Well, you should tell us then.
Well, I just want to hear. What? Yes, I will. What do you see as a difference in style? Or anybody who's had them both.
That's really interesting.
You don't know there's
our delivery is probably different. My sentences are probably
longer.
Maybe longer, full of creative words sometimes.
They're flourished.
Flourished.
Yeah, flourished.
But I don't know.
I would say Lee's probably more like somehow. You're a little similar in this, where if you come ask me a question, and he said this the other day, he's going to ask me questions and make you dig,
right.
And like, he's not just going to hand over the answer necessarily, he's going to send you in the direction that you should go, which I think is important, because part of being an agent is learning how to ask the right questions.
Right.
Tyler is different in the regard of like, sitting down and probably explaining things more. I don't know.
Equally. So you could, as an agent, pick and choose. Now, do I want a quick answer where they're just tell me about it, or do I want to go through an explanation?
Well, it depends on this. If you need the answer quickly, I'll get it to you.
Well, and I don't know. If you come to me, some agents have come into my office and asked me a question, and I'm silent for about 10 seconds, or maybe 30 seconds. But it's because I process it before I... And I'll tell them, hey, I need to think about this for a second before
completely.
Yeah, and I would say that, and I'll now chime in. I do think that shows where I would see the difference. I do think that you're on the surface initially much more outgoing, and you seem a little more reserved. Now, once you're all together, you're not reserved. But there is. Well, don't you think that Tyler has a little bit more of a, maybe reserved, isn't it?
Deliberate.
Thank you. That's kind of like you, Colin.
We're usually the two called out at the broker meetings of being just a little too quiet. And we're thinking. We're probably.
That's true. We do process.
Okay. Good. You're just,
I'm just
out
hot.
There, whatever. Well, it's funny. How do you think that's correlated to culture? Anything at the offices?
And we talked about this a little bit yesterday about how we switched. I went to East and he went to WeHo. I think that wouldn't be as much of a drastic change, I feel like, as if maybe Franklin and Hillsborough switched, or I feel like this worked very similar in kind of the makeup of the office. And
I do really believe that you're both in exactly the right offices for your style and personality. I really do. But, I mean, there is obviously going to be some that number. Okay. I think we beat that horse to death. So, just one more thing on that. How?
Just one thing.
It's got to be really dead.
Yeah.
So, you're telling me that if you did switch offices, you're going to hit me there. But thank you.
Uh-huh.
Would your agents notice a difference?
It would be louder in these, probably.
It would be?
Yeah. I don't know.
Is he quiet?
No, I'm just somewhat loud.
Robbie.
There'd be a lot more Britney.
Britney, like a person.
We'd have some pop music blaring throughout the place.
Yeah. I control the radio in the broker.
That's true. So I come into my office and I'll have like a candle going and like some, you know, like some deep work, you know, like music going.
Yeah.
So you come in my office and it's more of like a therapy.
Like kind of like getting a massage, like the music's playing.
Yeah.
I'm like.
Water. That's it. There you go. I asked you to describe the differences of your culture. There you go. Robbie's That's funny. All right. If an agent calls or texts you at 10 p.m. on a Friday night, would you be available?
Available? Yes.
Drunk?
Sober? That disclaimer was put out there pretty early on. I have a one or two. They're probably drunk too,
working. Okay. How about you, Tyler?
Yeah, usually.
So what I hear you saying it is if you have your at 10 o'clock at night, your phone is very close to you so that if it should even ring silent, you would know an answer.
My phone is always on silent.
So you would answer
at
10. You would. Do you have a cutoff time? At what time you don't? Do your agents know at what
time?
When
I go to sleep.
Do they know what time that is?
No.
So there's no.
But I usually don't have anyone call me at. I mean, rarely does someone call me at 10.
Really?
Yeah. No.
Okay. How about Sunday morning at 8:30?
Well, hopefully I'm not so drunk. Yeah, I think we're both pretty available.
Yeah.
That might be a question for the audience, though.
Does anybody call? Okay.
Tyler has helped me get into the East office. It was on
Sunday morning at 8:30.
It was on a Sunday or some weird time. I think it was on a Sunday.
Could have been.
And I couldn't get in and helped me get in. And
so I'm going to ask the audience, what, as agents, what is your, is that an expectation that you would expect of a broker?
No, because you have to be considerate of their time. If you have something come up and it's do or die, you know that they'll be there for you. But I wouldn't expect them to answer the phone at 11 o'clock at night, only because I'm trying to be considerate of their time.
But if you're calling, you are expecting something.
If
you
would, I would send a text message or something and say, I'm really sorry about you, but I'm going to fix.
Right.
is there any way you can call them? If they can't get back to me in the morning, well, then they can get back to me in the morning, because I feel like that's a little bit more outside of what we should expect it to be available to us. Most people, I think, understand that.
Bobby, I think we need to be honest, too. They pulled us all aside and said that all those Sunday morning calls would be good.
And you know, that's really working. That's really working. I have some doozers on Sunday morning. Does the refrigerator stay with the house?
I guess it depends on what the question is at 11 o'clock.
Deliver it.
Yeah.
Do y'all have policies, like, for communication? Maybe text me after 8 o'clock or...
You know, that is something, and I say this to you as agents, and I think, right, I really do think that there should be some policies with a caveat of in an emergency or a deadline, have some sort of text code. So that, because I had somebody tell me the other day that they get calls and the person's only calling late at night so that it will be in their voicemail when they wake up in the morning. Okay, so if that's true, then cool. So we have to have another code for 911. David?
This also has to do with us. I mean, what are we doing calling people at 10 o'clock at night? I'm unconscious at 10 o'clock. People, but I'm not doing real estate at 10 o'clock in the morning. I'm trying not to.
Well,
so I tell my clients, as Bobby Noreen says, did anybody die? So, you know, let's wait on this. I'll call the agent in the morning. I'm not calling this poor slob at 11 o'clock.
Well, not everyone. You know, and I don't say there are times where something really critical comes up
sure.
when you're dealing, especially in contract deadlines and, you know, an inspection where they're going to have to buy the house as is or... You know, so there are moments, but you're right, many, many times, as your clients do to you, they think that everything's urgent. So I wanted to make sure that there was a good expectation as to what you guys could expect, and I think that you need to, evidently it's not been a problem, so it's nothing you have to put on the wall, but, you know, it is good discussion, because I do think that that is one of the abuses of being a broker.
Abused so much.
Battered.
Battered.
It ain't.
Okay, so what is the most, so since that doesn't bother you at all, so take note that when you have a problem at 10 or Sunday morning.
Well, I would say, I mean, in the last year, I could probably count on one hand the number of times someone needed me after 10. But I will say, at my last company, there was... probably had more, but I kind of attribute that to the education.
Yeah.
I really do think village agents are the best.
How do you feel about,
educated.
And I'm going to ask Colin, and maybe this is a broker question for just us as a team, but how are the agents feeling with this all broker thing where I'm getting these questions from agents and it comes to all of us? And then it's and then well, I'm asking you guys too. How do we? Who responds first? Is it the first one to respond? Just chimes in. Or?
Personally, I think you should go to your broker first, and then if there's no answer and it is an emergency, then it would go to the.
What if it's after hours? That's right.
I still think you should call your broker first.
Okay. And then how?
Because ultimately, we're on the line for what.
And how long do you wait for a response before you throw it out to everyone? I'm asking you, agents, what's your expectations like? Because we have this now all broker. Am I the only one?
I used it yesterday.
Yeah.
You used it yesterday?
Yeah. I was trying to get into the marketplace and look at the new listing presentation.
Yeah.
So I just threw it out there. And Zach happened to be the first one to respond.
But you didn't need a question answered, like having to do with a contract.
No, it wasn't with a contract. It was just about the broker services and getting, you know, what's the mechanism of getting the marketplace fixed.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, we had one the other day, and I think three of us responded. I think the catch is that we have to make sure somebody lets the rest of the brokers, you know, I'm on it.
Right.
Yeah, and
well,
that works
all
the time.
I think in that scenario, I think it's been working pretty well. So, yeah, if I was about to call somebody, and then I see somebody's responded, hey, I'll call you right now, then it's like, okay, somebody else
And that's another thing. What happened, I know what you're talking about, and I'm just going to say this to the agents. There was a thing thrown out brokers, to all brokers, and then I got a call. And so, you know what I'm saying? So then I answered the call. So in terms of agents, there's got to be some sort of maybe 3 minutes. Because otherwise, you know, you can't just robo dial. And because then you're going to get a lot of everybody responding, and that's how that would happen. So, yes.
I was just curious, a question for you guys, sort of on this topic. Do you consider us all your agents, or is it I have my East agents, and then there's the Village agents, or I have my WeGo agents, and then there's everybody else? So I guess my question, to flip it, is should we as agents consider you all our brokers? You know what I'm saying?
Well, you know, I think in culture and style, yes, but in terms of liability and licensing, you know, each one is liable for the actions of the other. So I do think, and we talk in teams, that if it is something specific that's going to have a bearing on maybe good or bad news or whatever, I think we have to follow up if we're not the agent.
Sure.
But I certainly feel that, well, I have a different role, but I feel that everybody, I feel empowered or engaged or responsible for helping in that sense. But I think the liability standpoint is on each individual, and I think it's important that that broker know what's coming in their offices and with their agents. So that's why we do have broker meetings twice a month, and we talk about things. So there is that. So, I mean, I think it's the perfect solution for a company this size to have that access to that many people when you need them. I hope you're feeling that too. That's why it's important that everybody know all the brokers and know how valuable and educated and wonderful. Just wonderful.
We love all of our children equally. Maybe our specific term a little bit.
Yeah, so if a call comes in and there's one from their agent and one from somebody else's, they may call. Now, I hope you're all feeling very well cared for. Yes?
Because I was thinking that, you know, it was promoted to kind of use the broker's email, and I thought maybe that was a way of kind of spreading the questions, or I don't know. I mean, I was looking back to see how often I have used it. I've used it 4 times.
Yeah, you're
you know, normal. I mean, if it's during the day, or you know, or if I'm at the office, I'll go find a broker.
Right.
And
no, I think that was the point, was to make the agents and the size of the company feel that they have access and necessary someone that they can count on for support or help.
Which is not, I mean, it is not.
And you're feeling it. And that's our mission. Okay.
And we discovered last night that it works with OpenAssign too.
I did see that. I was like,
yeah.
Who signed?
Yeah,
I opened it up and asked all your name, and I'm like, I'm not signed.
Yeah, I did the same thing.
I did too. I went, wait.
I don't know.
That could get a little tricky because really,
that should.
It should be the broker for signatures, but it's working. That's the good.
I was surprised. I was like, oh, well, we all learned something.
Yeah,
right.
That worked.
I didn't see that.
What time of day was that?
Well, so somebody needed something signed, and they sent it to the broker's
email address.
So all of us got the invitation to sign for that particular broker, which was a bit of a surprise, but it worked. But ideally, yes, you do send that particular signature. For Zach, you can send an email, but yeah.
The colonists are forging.
Maybe that's like a non-emergency email address.
It's like
good
here.
Yeah.
So, having said that, what is the worst or most, maybe worst is very difficult part of your responsibility as a manager?
I think time management, but I think that goes back to
that leads on to our discussion.
Here we go. Just like my mother.
So,
but I think that's important, just a realtor in general. Like, we all have so many hours in a day, and
right.
such a balance. Like,
but you actually are doing a really good job, don't you think?
I'm trying.
Well, no, I mean, everybody is feeling very well cared for. And that's the point, is that you're managing your time so that you're getting done what you need to do for your own careers in life, but you're also feeling, making your agents feel that, that you're there for them. And I think you've done a really good job. What's your biggest
I agree.
Yours is time management.
Well, it is difficult to balance, you know, broker time and sales, and, you know, because I also need to pay the bills, and, you know, it's like, but I want to be available for the agents as much as I can and be in the office as much as I can. And so, you know, time management, it's tough, for sure.
So how do you do it?
I don't know, something.
it's an ongoing issue. Because you can burn yourself out, like, you get it, like, you're like, oh, I got this, and then it's year two, and you're like, okay, like, run out of steam here.
So do you use any particular method? I mean, we talk to agents that everybody has the same problem with whatever, but we talk about time blocking and being disciplined with focus. Any tricks, tips?
It is hard to time block. It's just, you know, it's one of those things where we're just so distracted by everything. Not even really the agents, just our clients are the most, I feel like, at least in my case, like the most out of burden, not a burden. But they don't know. It's easier to like set your times with like your agents and then like set for clients, but like they can just go around that and text you whenever and all that kind of stuff.
So you haven't, as I'm hearing, set up boundaries with your agents or your clients with expectations of when they can reach you.
The only boundary I've set up with, I tell agents is, hey, if I don't answer, it means I'm busy. And I don't think anyone has ever thought that if I don't answer that I'm just ignoring them. Like, I think they know that I'm either, and I'll tell them, like, hey, if I don't answer at 7:30 at night, I'm probably eating dinner with Hannah.
So
like,
is there a time frame that you call back?
Yeah, I mean, I just tell them I'll call you back right after I'm, right when I'm free.
So if somebody calls you and you don't answer, how long should they wait before they start calling every other broker?
I have not felt like I have had that issue yet. If I see the missed call, I'm like, I'll call you in 20 minutes, I'll call you in 15 minutes.
So is that your kind of goal, is to call
just
them?
To give them a time frame of when.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, they are just crushing it, aren't they? So who's in Tyler's office that's here today? Okay. Who's in Lee's office that's here today?
Yay, we have. They're watching, obviously.
They're watching.
There's thousands out there.
Thousands.
So, what is the one piece of advice that you find yourself giving to agents over and over? So, the same issue or problem keeps rising.
So the question is, what's their contract say?
You know, that's what they say to you.
No, that's what I say to them. If they have a question, I always go back to the contract. What's the contract say?
So would you say it's because the agents don't know what the contract says?
Sometimes. Or maybe it's my way of saying, read it, process it, and then re-ask the question.
Okay.
I thought about this, and I don't know if I have a mantra or something I say all the time, but usually when an agent comes in to me and needs help with something, I like to go back to the beginning. Because sometimes an agent comes in and they have a problem and they're at step five, but the answer lies in step two. So I like to just, every time, I'll take it back to the very beginning. So, okay, what's the situation here? Start from the beginning of the story and let's...
Yeah, I do find that we get so excited that we start in the middle of the movie. And when you're a broker, you've got to go back and find out. Yeah. So the one thing that I always found that I always had to ask, and I know you guys do, is who do you represent?
Yeah.
because they'll start a story and I will not have a clue what side of the table, because that makes it. So I'm just offering that as a piece of advice. When you call with an issue, start with, I represent the seller or I represent the buyer. Because after about 15 minutes, we have no idea where we stand. So that's always important things. So complete this sentence.
Oh, here we go.
You know, I sent these
to you. Yeah, you did.
I could have just kept them from you.
Yeah.
Complete the sentence. I wish I could blank so that the agents in my office would be able to blank.
Can't be dirty.
Can't be dirty. Wish I had an overabundance of leads so that my agents could have an overabundance of business. How about that?
Oh.
I can't beat that.
I've been thinking on that question.
Oh, say it one more time. That was so lovely. The hearts were floating around. I don't
remember what I said. Overabundance. I did. Overabundance of leads. So my agents have an overabundance of business.
Oh, we're going to make that.
Can we put it on the wall?
Needle point.
Yes, yes. Put it on the pillow.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
I really don't know how to top that.
Well,
I wish I could do something to make my agents soar on the wings of eagles.
Yes. Oh.
I need to come up with this first word. What's the first word I can put in there?
You know, that's really aspirational. Which, when I wrote that question, I wasn't even thinking it would become aspirational.
Well, Bob, that's the way I read it.
Complete this list.
No. In your opinion, what is the most important aspect of the principal broker of an office? Or the most important?
To me, it's culture building.
Availability, encouragement, like support, honestly. And you're a sounding board a lot of times. Sometimes you just gotta bitch to somebody, you know, about your.
Do either of you confer or rely on each other?
Often. Yeah, we do. Often.
So you do become a support group for each other.
Yeah.
I know you've created some wonderful events and things that you're individualized. I think that's culture. I know we do things as a whole company, but I think that uniqueness to each. You had kickball.
Yeah,
that was a fun thing. Not for me. Some people had a great time.
They want to do it again.
Well, team one won, so.
And that's your team.
That was my team.
Of course. Who would have doubted?
There was the Richard Simmons outfit.
All right, I want to talk before I get to the very last question about delivery. So that was another thing that yesterday, if you all just came in, we had a contract connection at GNR where the YPN, the Young Professional Network, had teams write contracts based on a buyer scenario and a particular listing they pulled on MLS. Had four teams, and it was a multiple offer situation, so we had four offers from different teams, and they had to make their offer the most appealing based on the scenario that they had with their buyer, and I got to be the judge.
I mean, she loved every second of it. She did. It was judge.
I want you to know, I was really nervous the night before I couldn't sleep.
Really?
Yes, because I knew I was going to be testing with that escalation clause.
But
so,
you had no idea.
Yeah, right. But we accepted that escalation clauses could be good or bad, depending. They're not always great, and don't just throw them out there unless you want to call me for the most outrageous escalation clause in the plan. But there was, huh?
I love that escalation.
It's good.
Oh, I bet you bought, you wrote it.
No, we didn't.
You would be the only agent that would ever know what the hell that was on.
It had me a bona fide offer. I was like, I'm keeping this one. That's what stumped you.
It didn't. I just couldn't even follow. They were reading it to me, and it, by about the last third or fourth comma,
Anyway,
but I want to talk about delivery, because that came in again and again about who binds an offer. And there was so many people say the agent binds the offer by writing in the deed. And you know how horrific I am about that. The agents don't bind offer. I'm glad you're here, Lloyd, because I want you to put on your, you call that hat you always wear? That attorney hat?
Attorney hat.
Pin.
Yeah.
Okay. So my technical philosophy is a technical bit. Until it's delivered, the contract is not bound. Okay? That you can have a seller, buyer sends a contract, seller loves it, checks accepted, and then nothing happens. If it doesn't get back to the agent saying this has been accepted and delivered, it's not a bound contract. And somebody could come in and offer a higher, and the seller is in the absolute rights to take that offer, correct? Now, somebody, as they always do, came up to me on a break and said that another very prominent attorney in town says that's not true, that it is bound when the buyer and the seller sign and accept. So, you know, I'm not one to correct an attorney. But if you call somebody on the phone and say, my seller signed it, it's accepted, is that considered delivery?
I think not. Because in the first five chapters of every law school course in contracts, they talk about the objective intent of the parties. And you can't have a subjective or secret intent of the parties. So if I sign a contract to sell my house to Lee, and I accept his offer, and I put it in a drawer and leave it there for 10 years, is he bound to buy that for 10 years when I never told him to?
What if you call him and said, I accept it?
Yeah. Well, under our boilerplate contract, verbal notice is not notice. You have to give written notice. And so written notice is delivered.
Thank you. And the good news about the verbal and what you said, an email would be notice.
It would be considered notice, and I think it gets a little more.
Then it gets a little, at least if you were at the Preds game. The best bet, not text, because it's notice. I would at least do an email. I think you have a little more strength. To stand on that with acceptance. And I was remiss to say that yesterday, and because people were really talking about, well, what if we called and I was, you know, because we're at the Preds game and we can't deliver. And I got thinking last night as I was laying in bed, thinking, well, maybe if you, because of the notice, if you send an email saying, I will follow up, but my seller has, I don't know if that would hold more weight or water. Yeah. Thank you, Lloyd.
So are you going to tell us, to use David Payne's term, who the slob was that had the poor slob?
The other attorney?
Slob, yeah.
Absolutely, in no way. You will have to torture me with waterboarding.
So cocktails it is.
Yes, right, exactly.
Lots of waterboarding.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, the last question I have on my list is, what makes your village office the best? That's not the question.
Yes.
What makes I'm going to ask it twofold. What makes your office thrive? And what makes the village thrive in your view?
The agents. Is that a cliche answer?
No, but it's a little less than deep. For you, especially.
Well, that was exhausted up here.
It's almost over.
Okay. I don't know, we talked about this question yesterday, too.
We did?
No, we did.
And what did you guys come up with?
Well, so I think, and I'll just, I mean, going back to the story of sort of how the East office has come from when I started to now. I mean, it really is the agents from the short, sweet answers agents, but from the broker perspective, I mean, our job, and I really think the broker has responsibility to launch the culture, we build the framework so that the agents can build the culture. We give them the ability, and we get them together so they can build the relationships to build the culture. So we just provide the meetings or, you know, the fun activities. You know, we obviously give support, but we build the framework and get the right people in the office, and then they're going to build it. And that's really what's been happening in the East office. I've been putting together, we have a once a month meeting, but it's not the Tyler show. It's the agents that show up and they make relationships with each other.
You know, there's something true about that, and then I want to counter that with something else. But, you know, when you said it's the agents that show up, you're right. When you show up, you say, well, there's 300 agents, they're not going to miss me, or something, or whatever. But the reality is if everybody has that feeling, then it lacks energy and enthusiasm. And so people just showing up has a collaborative energy that provides that culture and support that I think everybody needs. So you guys, those sales meetings, the collaboratives, all the things that we put on the events, the kickoff, it's somebody has to show up to make it happen. So I agree with that 100%. I also do believe, though, that you can have a whole lot of wonderful agents, and if you don't have a good person broker that rallies and centers them all together, like you said, plans the events. And I can see how you can look at any of them, especially the East office, because it's been around for a very long time, and it's had different brokers. And you can see the difference of the culture in that office every time there's a change in brokerage. When you say, who's in the East office? Of course, you guys haven't been as long to see, but trust me, it's true. And not bad, just different. And it'll attract different types of agents. So the one thing that I always say when I'm doing broker courses is the most important tool or retention tool in a company is what? The most important retention tool in a company or an office is what?
If people feel like they have a stake there,
is the broker. You are so to your offices and to the whole. Because you are the glue that brings it together. Your personality, your style, your initiatives, your inspiration is going to be the spark that creates the culture. So we are so very blessed and privileged to have both of you in the rest of your hand. You're in the right seats at the right time. Bus, and I hope you stay on the bus.
Purple bus.
And I'm going to close. If there's any more questions that you want to ask to these two phenomenal brokers, say it now. Yeah?
I would be curious to know what has been the most challenging issue you've had to help an agent with, particularly contractually, when they come to you with an issue. What has been the most challenging that you've really been concerned that we were all going to be fined, you know, $1,000 a piece?
Is that all?
Or we have the potential of losing our license.
Oh, yes.
So have you had those kinds of things to deal with?
I luckily have not. I've had sellers that have decided they're not
going to
sell.
Oh, then I need to join your office.
Yeah. I've had sellers or the client who has totally violated the contract and they're going to be in trouble. But as of yet, I have not had. And we've had agents that we got one the other day that I can't wait till we file an ethics complaint on. So on the other side that has been. We're doing it. So luckily, I have not, but Tyler, I don't know if you've had any.
Never had anyone threaten to take our license or anything like that. I'm trying to think of a specific example, because I know that horror stories are fun to hear.
They are. Yeah. And you learn a lot from them. Really?
Do you want to share?
No. Bobby shares mine all the time in her trainings. I'm so happy I created this story.
Yeah,
it's true.
Yeah, but that one was the only one I've ever lost.
That was a bad one.
But it really wasn't. It was so silly in terms of your error.
Yes.
Jane, just so you know, had to renew her license. She had all her education, and she was right on time, and she went in and put the credit card in and went on. And then 6 months or something, we found out that she'd been working and getting commissions, and that her license was expired on that. She had failed to hit submit. You know how you, like, you make an order and you hit order, or she just went on thinking she'd done it. And there was no way that we could, you know, tell the real estate commission that was not happening.
Right.
And they said, too bad.
You know, and it really came about as a result of a collision, pretty much, between me and another realtor. And so this realtor...
In the company.
Yeah. And this realtor made a point to research me. And so after it was all done, and I...
And they turned her in.
And he turned me in. I mean, I was really kind of grateful because, I mean, the fine is even more. The longer you're working with no license, your fine really goes up. So, I mean, I was grateful after everything smoothed out and it all resolved itself. But I would never have known. I mean, I thought I was...
Now, that really doesn't happen. It was a perfect storm because Village has some stop gaps in the financing department where it comes up and we can't cut a check if your license is expired to protect everybody. But... It was a perfect storm, and somehow that particular person and that particular, it didn't happen.
Well, I'll say in general, you know, if an agent has, if there's a contract dispute, that's easier because there's a contract. It's in writing. The hardest situations that I've had to deal with are agents getting pissed at other agents, and then they start saying, well, I'm going to turn you in a track, and there it becomes this, we're all just going to turn each other into track, and we'll all lose our licenses, and, you know, for what? You know, and I've mediated that a few different times between agents. And that's honestly been the hardest.
Those are the hardest when it's between.
Does anybody
want to
know mine? So I get a call from a seller that we represented, and it's about 4 o'clock on an afternoon. And the seller says, "You know, I'm calling because are you the broker or the manager?" I said, "Yeah, this was what it was." And he says, something really weird happened at closing. I said, no. He said, yeah, they told me that I had to get $5,000 to the buyer, but they weren't going to put it on anything. It wasn't going to be on the closing statement. And so I did, but I was going to call the real estate commission about seeing if that was copacetic, or I thought I'd call you and see what you think. So that was one of those cases where I had to call, and sure enough, that had happened. And the man got his $5,000 back, but not from the buyer. So those are those kind of things. So if you are an agent, those are the things that bring fear and strike.
Yeah.
Whew, into the heart of brokers when things like that happen. So please try to be careful.
And if there's any doubt, ask.
Just ask.
Because I'd rather have someone ask before they get all the way to closing and just assume.
Yeah. I want to give you a round of applause. I hope you did feel safe and good and supported and loved because you did a great job. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
And
all.
I guess you're all going to stay, aren't we? Having a cook-off?
Bye, Nick.
Well, should we shake hands like her?
Thank you for the car for you.
It's like Village
cars. Purple cars.